today on how to develop a robust selling strategy online for online. Today we've really got two presentations which are jam-packed. The first presentation will be an overview given by myself on how to sell online and the different strategies for selling online. And then the second part of the presentation will be on IPR strategies and how to tackle the IPR challenges faced when selling online. And to do that, we have Ms. Stacey Yuen from Jones Day. So Stacey, if you'd like to say a quick hello.
Hi, everyone.
Okay. And so the first thing to do, actually, is just to do a bit of administration. And just to remind you that if you want to ask any questions during the webinar, then there's the questions box here, and you just have to type in the question, and then the question will go through to our staff, who will put it through to the speakers. Just to remind you as well, my name is Chris Chong, and I am the director of the EU SME Center, and today I'll be giving the presentation on the online strategies, the overview of how to sell online in China. But first of all, before we get to that, let me just give you a quick overview of what the EU SME Center does, just in case you haven't seen any of our webinars before. The first thing about the EU SME Center is that we are an EU-funded project, funded by the European Union, and we're here to really help European SMEs enter the China market in terms of export and investment in China. And to do that, we offer free confidential information and advice and practical support services. The practical support services and information and advice looks like this. In terms of information and advice, we answer inquiries, we write lots of documentation and publications, we provide training, webinars, and this today is an example of one of them. And then on our website, you'll find a whole range of information that will be very useful for you in terms of databases. On the support services side, the office itself is a service, and European SMEs, when they come to Beijing, they can use our hot desks for a temporary stay. And also, if there's any delegations, business delegations coming across, then we can give them briefings. And in terms of events, we also help in terms of providing matchmaking and networking. We specialize in four key areas of expertise. Business development, which is under which this online selling training is being given, so it falls under business development. And then we have a standards and conformity advisor, and then we give advice on HR and training, and also legal advice as well. Now, one of the really hot subjects recently in the Chinese business environment has been selling online. And to tackle that, we've also written a report. So much of the content of today's presentation you can also read on the online report, which you can download for free from our website. And the report covers trends, models for selling online, key players, consumer behavior, and the issue of logistics. Today's presentation is a bit more up to date with the latest figures, but if you want to have something to read, then you can read the report online as well. Another report, or another series of reports that I want to highlight to European SMEs is the recent diagnostic toolkit that we produced recently. And the toolkit is made up of four areas. Is China on your radar? Ways to enter the Chinese market? Then there's a report on exporting goods to China. And then a key question is about how you carry out due diligence, and that's carried out in the fourth report about knowing your partners in China. The fifth part of the toolkit is a questionnaire, and European companies can do a self-assessment to see how ready they are for the Chinese market. And on the questionnaire, you'll find a whole range of questions, ranging from IPR issues to market access issues, legal issues in terms of setting up companies in China. And then you just answer the questions, and then you'll get immediate feedback on how ready you are for the Chinese market in terms of the score. The final thing to mention about the center is that all our publications and all our services are available online, and you can access everything that I've talked about through the EU SME Center website, and you can see the website address here. If you're looking also to find out more about our future events and our future trainings, which are carried out both in Europe and in China, then you can also look on the website at our events and webinar calendar. But now we're moving on to the main topic of today. And as I said, I'm going to be giving the overview, and I really wanted to tackle the fundamental questions of how to sell online in China. So the four areas, or the three areas I'll be looking at in particular, are why should you even be considering selling online in China? The second part will be about the consumers in China, the Chinese buyers online who are buying the actual products. So who's buying? And then the third part is probably the one that everyone is most interested in, is how do you actually do it? And then at the end, I'll just be going very briefly through a couple of case studies which show the best practices and challenges of selling online in China through the eyes of two companies. So let's have a quick look at the first part about why you should be selling online. And I think anybody that's been looking at China has seen the incredible growth that's taken place over the last few years, particularly post-WTO accession in 2001. And everybody knows about the GDP growth of averaging around 10%. And this is also reflected in the growth in terms of mobile internet users and internet users. And this is really what is driving the online selling phenomenon at the moment in China. So you can see here that mobile internet users has now reached about 419 million users in China out of a population of 1.3 billion. And internet users is now 564 million. Now, the even more impressive thing about this is that the penetration rate that this represents is actually quite low, especially when you compare this to the US and you compare it to Europe. So if you look at China, the penetration that those 500 million people represent only represents a penetration rate of 40.1%, whilst in the US, the penetration rate has already reached 78%, and in Europe it is 63.2%. And so on the China side, it looks like there's still much room for further expansion. In terms of market value as well, in terms of online selling, in terms of consumer to consumer and business to consumer, the market for both these areas, you can see that it has been growing exponentially since 2007 and even before then. The other phenomenon to look at here, or the other trend to really note, is that the business to consumer market is increasing at a much quicker rate than the consumer to consumer market. And that's because really people's behaviors are changing. Before, they were buying smaller items and cheaper items online, but now they're looking for a more developed service and more sophisticated products. So in terms of the market, in terms of business to consumer, this will make up 40% of the market by 2014. And in terms of e-commerce, in terms of the total retail sales, it will make up 7.4% of the country's total retail value by 2015. And so even right now, you can see that the growth in this area is growing very, very, very quickly. Another phenomenon to note is in terms of mobile commerce sales. So the number of smartphones in China has increased very, very rapidly. And even compared with the US, which is the blue bars here, where the e-commerce sales have reached $31 billion by 2015 projected, China is set to overtake that in 2014. And in 2015, China is looking to be carrying out $41.4 billion worth of sales through mobile phones. And so e-commerce is a particularly good way of tackling the market in China. Obviously, the Chinese market is absolutely massive. And there's some reasons why people should be considering e-commerce, in particular in China. The first one, though, is the same, I think, throughout for everywhere around the world. It allows, if you start an online shop, you'll be open 24 hours a day. And so your presence in terms of marketing presence will always be there for people to access. The second reason, though, is particularly for China, there's many second and third tier cities beginning to open up and develop quickly economically. And so it makes sense for people to market to these areas instead of starting up a bricks and mortar shops, that they can market to these places by using an online presence. The other key message here, though, is that when you're looking at online, you can't really just think of it in terms of just one shop, a virtual shop online, and you should really be thinking of it in terms of a strategic tool with regard to your other platforms, your bricks and mortar shops in China as well. And finally, of course, online presents a very effective way of marketing to shoppers in China, and is a good way to reach out, as I said before, to those, particularly in the remote areas in the second and third tier cities. Now, looking a bit about the different consumers in China, who are the actual people buying the goods, and what are the different types of things that they're buying? Well, the number of online buyers has increased and is set to increase very quickly over the next few years. You've got about 220 million people buying online at the moment, and this is going to increase by 2016 to 423 million people. The types of people buying, I think, as in other places around the world, are mostly young people. So if you look at the mobile users, 60% of them are 25 to 35 years old. And the other thing to note is that many of these buyers are still based in the more developed areas of China, which is on the East Coast. In terms of statistics, emphasizing again that it is very much a young person's phenomenon, the biggest segment of people buying online are students, 28.6%, and then followed by managerial, non-managerial, white-collar staff, the younger employees normally, 18.2%. Stacey, you seem to be smiling there. Are you one of those? Are you one of those buyers?
Well, I'm definitely not the students category, yes. But I see women buyers account for 45% of all the internet users. That's why I pull up.
Yes, I think that's the other phenomenon to mark as well. Yeah. I mean, before it was very much a male-dominated phenomenon with people buying electronics goods primarily, yeah. But now it's changed to more buying of daily goods. And so that's why I think it accounts for women being much more involved in online buying, making up 45% now of all internet buyers, or sorry, all internet users, and this is up from 20% 10 years ago. Yes. Does that reflect what you think of the market?
Oh, yeah.
I guess you're buying online.
Speaking from my own experience, yes.
Yes. And then this map from The Economist just goes to show what I was talking about just now, that it's very much a Eastern Coast phenomenon. With internet penetration being much more on the eastern side, and you're looking at really the Bohai Rim, which is up in the north near Beijing, and then you're looking at the Yangtze River Delta around Shanghai, and then the Pearl River Delta around the Guangdong province. And just some figures from Access Asia, which emphasize, I think, the changes in people's buying behavior. As I said before, people were buying 3C goods before, so that's electronic goods, computers, and things like this. And this, I think, accounted for why there's such a dominance in terms of male people buying online. But even so, you can see that it is still the biggest in terms of value, in terms of online selling. And you can see that the growth for 3C products is still very high. I mean, if you look at the right column, you look at all those figures, the growth rate is almost over 100% for all of those figures. And the items in bold, fashion, cosmetics, daily goods, food, baby products, mentions the trend that I was mentioning before about how people are moving much more to daily goods. Yeah. So 3C was 3C in publications, and DVDs was one of the reasons why people were buying stuff before, but now people are going or integrating it more into their daily life. And people's buying behavior is also changing. Before, people were extremely price sensitive, and that was the reason for going online. It's because you could get cheap goods, and they weren't willing to risk much, actually, in terms of buying extremely large ticket items. So they were looking for really cheap prices and convenience.
Yep.
But this is changing, and, well, to a certain extent, people are still, I think, looking for cheap prices and convenience, yep. But now they're also looking for variety and much, much more better services. And better services, I'm talking in terms of not just the online experience, but I'm talking also about logistics and delivery as well. Okay, and this is emphasized in the chart on the right. Recent research shows actually that Chinese consumers compared with US consumers are actually even more price sensitive when it comes to buying goods online. So now to the third part of the question, which is about how you access the market. And on this point, before we head into this section, I'd like to just ask the audience just to get some idea of your background. And so right now, I'm just going to launch a poll to see, you know, what the backgrounds of the audience are in terms of what your considerations are for selling online in China, in terms of what your plans are. So I'm just going to launch a poll now, and I'd like you to take a few seconds to tick one of the boxes just to show us what you're up to in terms of your online plans. So here we go. If you can just put down your answers, I'll give you a few more seconds. And I'm now going to close the poll just to show you the answers. And I will share with you the answers. So, as you can see from the answers, most people are still at the beginning stage of finding out about their online strategy in the Chinese market. But the second statistic there actually surprises me. A lot of people are doing their own standalone websites. And that surprises me because from our research, it seems to be much more easy to access online in China via an online platform like Taobao or Tmall. You avoid all the issues about ICP licenses and things like this. But I guess the reason why small businesses might in particularly want to go for a more individual website is because of branding and niche product issues. So I can understand that to a certain extent as well. So if we can move now on to the next part about how to access the market. As I was saying, we've been researching this for a while. And so one of the things that we've done during our research is just to provide an overview of how people should approach the market. And there are quite a few steps that you should be considering when you enter the Chinese market. The first one is selecting a platform. Which one? The dominant ones, as I'll show you later, are Tmall and Taobao, which are both Alibaba platforms. So you should be thinking in terms of business consumer or consumer to consumer. Taobao is the consumer to consumer platform, which is dominating at the moment, and Tmall is dominating in terms of the business to consumer platforms. But then there are others as well, and you'll have to choose the one that fits your products the best. If you decide to go for a standalone platform, then you're going to be also thinking about an ICP license, which is the Internet Content Provider license, which is for any website which is based on a web server in China. You'll need to obtain this license. Another aspect to consider is also the language of the website. It's amazing how many people just use an English website, but obviously when you're selling in China, Chinese should be the language that you're thinking about. Then you should also be thinking about how you market your products, especially in terms of online tools, so how you would optimize your search engines, search engine optimization. And then many of the websites, again, like Tmall and Taobao, they will have their own advertising tools and promotion tools, which you can subscribe to as well. I'm actually not going to go into that too much today because we've actually done a webinar on digital marketing before, which you can find and download on our website, and which we'll go into it in much more detail. The next part you'll have to then consider is how you actually get your products from Europe into the Chinese market. And the thing to remember here is that when you're bringing your goods into the Chinese market, you're going to have to get through certain standard inspection and certification procedures. If you have a standard which applies to your product in Europe, for example, represented by the CE mark, then the chances are there will be a standard and a certification procedure for your product in China as well. Once you get through the market access issues, then you'll have to consider where you store the goods. And this is actually quite a big challenge in China. There is actually quite a lot of storage space, but in terms of the actual handling of the goods and the services provided by these logistics providers, it's actually not that sophisticated yet, especially in second and third tier cities. So when you're looking at the lower tier cities, which is a strategy for many SMEs, then you should be really considering, is there a place that I can inventory, or where, which hubs do I use to get my goods actually to those second and third tier cities? To do that, you're going to have to do some research into the distributors and providers. I provide some information here later in this presentation as well. Connected to that, again, with logistics, you're going to have to ship the product to the customers. And again, the different providers, they have different types of services and a different range of networks. Some will cover some cities or some regions better than others. And then the last questions to answer, really, or to consider, is the payment collection procedure. Is it going to be cash on delivery? Is it going to be credit card? The platforms, to a certain extent, help you with this. But if you have a standalone platform, then you'll have to consider this a bit more. And then the final step you've got to be really thinking about is in terms of after-sales services. So especially when you've got your goods here and you're selling it to the Chinese consumers, perhaps through a distributor or through an agent here, how do you monitor the follow-up and the after-sales services when they get to the actual consumer? The other thing to know about this is that many people, when they think about online, they're only really thinking about the first two stages. But you really got to think about the whole process and the costs involved in the whole process. There's low startup costs for online, which are quite deceptive, because really when it comes down to the marketing, the ongoing social media, the managing of the logistics providers, and then the after-sales services, in terms of time and in terms of money, it actually can amount to quite a lot. So you have to take that into account. And so in terms of the key online selling models, there is four key ways that we thought that EU SMEs could tackle the market. And this is by in terms of whether you have a website outside China or a website inside China. And then you have the decision of whether you want a standalone website or if you want to use a third-party platform like the ones I've been mentioning. And I think the first thing to mention is that you don't really have to just go for one. Many companies will go for a hybrid or a mixture of platforms and or going from a standalone and a third-party platform at the same time. It really depends on your marketing needs. However, there are some distinct advantages to each of these models. If, for example, you're selling outside, you do not need the Internet Content Provider license. This is only really for websites in China. However, if that's the case, then you are more susceptible to being blocked by the authorities in China. The other thing is, if you're outside, there's always the risk of shipping the goods into China and then delays. Chinese customers right now, they're very much into fast delivery. If you order something, they almost expect it to be delivered overnight and at the door the next morning. Okay, so if you're delivering overseas, the delay is going to be 1 or 2 weeks. It's probably not going to be viable for the Chinese market right now. And so we're really looking, I think, more, or the report really indicates that the platforms or the website inside China is probably the best way to go because of the faster delivery and because also Chinese consumers trust platforms like Tmall and Taobao much, much more. Also, third-party platforms in China have existing services which Chinese consumers know how to use and are very familiar with already. The other thing, though, to mention that if you have a standalone website in China, then you will require the Internet Content Provider license. If you're selling your own goods, actually, it's quite straightforward to get that license. However, if you want to become another Taobao and you want to become a platform to sell other people's products, then actually to get the license, which is called the Commercial ICP license, it's actually quite difficult. And just in terms of the different platforms, we have, as I mentioned before, in terms of the B2C platforms in China, you have Tmall, which is dominating with 44%. Then you have Jingdong, which follows second, 16%, and Tencent. And so the Alibaba Group platforms, such as Tmall and Taobao, as you can see here, in terms of the consumer-to-consumer platforms, you can see the Alibaba platforms are really dominating. As many people will be considering Taobao or Tmall to enter the Chinese market, I thought I'd give you a bit more information on how these different platforms work. Taobao is a consumer-to-consumer platform. It covers 90.7% of the market share at the moment, so very high. But for European SMEs to enter this platform, they're going to need a Chinese guarantor. And that means somebody in China that is willing to put or use their identity details so that they can register on the website for you. It's very much a consumer-to-consumer platform, so it's for individuals. It's free. And the other thing to watch out for here is the grading system. The grading system for both these platforms are very important. If you lose half a star in your ranking system, then this can greatly influence your sales. So that's something to watch out for. Tmall is the much more developed platform. It's, an Alibaba website, and it's primarily what it is, a business-to-consumer website. But for this one, as it's much more developed, you will need a registered company to register on this website and to get their services or to put a shop onto their platform. The thing to note here is that there's costs involved when you open a Tmall shop. There's a deposit of 50,000 RMB, but this can change depending on the different sector that you are or the different products that you're selling on their platform. So, for example, if you're selling shoes, I think the deposit is 50,000 RMB, but if you're selling something a bit more risky, such as medical devices, then the deposit is much higher, about 100,000 RMB.
I don't think you can set up a medical shop on Tmall yet.
Okay.
Medical is still controlled. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So if there's any more sensitive types of product,
or more expensive type.
More expensive type, then the deposit will be much higher. And then again, this is reflected in the annual service charge as well, which ranges from 30,000 RMB to 60,000 RMB. But the good thing is that Tmall is really promoting sales at the moment. So the higher your sales revenue, they're willing to give you a discount on the annual service charge. And you can find out more about that on their website. The other issue I wanted to talk about today is in terms of getting your goods to the Chinese consumer, and the logistics market in China is extremely fragmented, and there's many, many players providers that can help you to get your goods out to the Chinese consumers in different regions. And the thing is, when you're doing or choosing your provider, you're going to have to be very careful, because different ones will have different regional strengths, and they will have different strengths in terms of their services and in terms of their coverage. And this research by A.T. Kearney, I think, shows this very well. So you can see the providers, like the national provider, EMS, which is the China Post provider, has a very wide coverage, I think, of about 20,000 locations in China. So they can cover most areas in China. However, in terms of their services, in terms of warehousing and the sophisticated services and handling of the goods, then they might not be as good as the other providers. You can also see the foreign providers here in terms of FedEx. They're also in the market. They concentrate much more on particular regions, particularly in the eastern coast of China. They have a much higher service delivery level, but there's a trade-off because they're also much more expensive. In the online selling report, you can find out a bit more. We go into a bit more depth in terms of these different providers, and there's links to all these providers also in the online selling report, and that will give you much more information on their different levels of service. And just another thing to watch out for in terms of the logistics in China is that, okay, the networks are expanding. There's many more providers that can reach out to the second and third tier cities. But in terms of the service level, some of them are still not at a very high rate yet. So if you're looking at particularly fragile items, high-value sensitive electronic items or temperature-sensitive items like particular foods, then you're going to have to choose your providers very, very carefully. The other challenge to look out for is particularly in holiday seasons, it can get very, very busy, and so there'll be delays in terms of service delivery. And so because of these challenges, many of the big players, and actually I know some European SMEs, particularly in the food industry, are thinking about building their own logistics networks and storage facilities. So another cost to potentially consider as well. I'm just about running out of time now. It's about half an hour. I better leave some time for Stacey.
Okay.
But there's a couple of case studies that you'll also find on our website. One is called Plastered 8 T-Shirts, which is a small British businessman who started up a shop in Beijing and has basically been putting Chinese designs on T-shirts and sending it to Chinese consumers. And he's been extremely popular. And as I mentioned before, when you're considering online, you shouldn't really just consider it in terms of the online shop. but in terms of how it fits within your overall strategy. So Dominic, who is the owner of Pastor Day T-shirts, has a Tmall store, he has his own website, and he has a bricks and mortar store, and they each serve different needs within his business model. The other case study on our website is a much bigger company. It's called Everwines, which is part of the Taurus Group, and they're starting to sell wine in China via online. They've only just started up, but their key strategy will be to target niche wines and niche markets in China. And again, you can find these case studies online. There's some challenges and best practice that I just want to finish up on, and which are highlighted in the case studies as well. The first one Stacey's going to be dealing with very soon, and that's about IPR, exposing your IPR to the online selling market, and also not just that, but the domain name for your website as well. So Stacey will be telling you a bit about that in a second. The second point is about price sensitivity. Chinese consumers, extremely price sensitive. If you put your goods on Taobao especially, I think, they will not be very loyal, and they'll switch to another provider very quickly if there's a very small difference in price. So another thing to consider when you're approaching the market. You've got to carry out your market research, really, to know where to pitch your prices. The third one I've just mentioned just now is about logistics. Choose your providers very carefully. Chinese consumers are expecting extremely fast delivery. And so if you're looking at second and third tier cities in particular, picking the logistics provider is going to take you some time. So take your time again to carry out the research there. The next thing is, don't expect that you can just export your goods directly to China without going through some administrative process in terms of standards, conformity, and certification requirements. And as you mentioned before, selling goods like medical devices or pharmaceuticals products is pretty restricted in China. So it's something to look out for as well. Don't underestimate how long it takes to get through the process, set up an online shop, ship things out, and carry out the after-sales service. It actually takes quite a long time to plan and to execute online selling in China, so another area to look out for. And the last thing is, and it's funny how many people forget this, but obviously when you're thinking about selling in China, unless you're selling extremely luxury goods, then you should be really thinking about marketing your brand in Chinese to the Chinese market, because that's obviously the language that everybody will be talking about. The other things to look out for is watch out for feedback. Online service and after-sales service is very important. People I found in China, I think, will complain very, very quickly if your goods are not delivered very quickly, or if there's anything wrong with the goods themselves, they will complain very, very quickly. And then from the Plaster Date case study, you'll see how Dominic manages customer relations very well and his marketing very well. So basically keep in touch with your customers through promotions and online selling. Get to understand their needs very, very clearly. And then just the reiteration of what I just mentioned before. Think end to end. The whole process, not just the starting up of the shop itself, which is actually relatively easy. And then the last thing is, if you're going to do it, you're going to do online properly. Think about the whole process and make sure you have the resources, the time, and the capital to really make it successful. I've mentioned a few reports during the presentation. I'm sorry if I've gone through it relatively quickly. I think there's a bit of content there. The three reports, or the three things I've mentioned, were the online selling report, and then there's two case studies, the Faster Date case study, and the Everwines case study. And one thing I've mentioned, which is not there, is the webinar on digital marketing, which you can find on the web link, which is just listed above there, at usmecenter.rg.cn. And if you just click on the Knowledge Center, you'll be able to find all our research and content on online selling in China. And on that note, I will now move over for Stacey, who will be now tackling the most difficult part of the presentation on IPR, online selling, and the IPR issues and challenges involved in selling online in China. So let me just switch presentations. There you go. Over to you, Stacey.
Okay, thank you, Chris. Thank you. Okay, now, well, first of all, at the beginning of my presentation, I'm going to have to do a little bit of introduction of the China IPR SME Help Desk, which is actually founded under the European Commission. So they asked me to have a little bit of introduction here on behalf of the China IPR SME Help Desk. Well, they actually have not only in China for the SME Help Desk in relation to IPR issues. They have recently, actually in January, just set up a Southeast Asia IPR SME Help Desk. The Help Desk is free and is available to all the EU SMEs and the intermediate companies. The Help Desk actually mainly provided four kind of services. They do, first of all, they have the inquiry service. I think I can have the next slide. Oh, okay. I'll jump on this slide first. I think they have the, yeah, here, the agenda. Sorry, I jumped too fast on the introduction to the Help Desk. Okay, yeah, here it is. So, yeah. So here you can see that they have a website, which also take all the inquiries. All the services are free and absolutely confidential. So when you have any initial question, you can actually contact them online, and they will promise to get back to you within 7 working days. They also have, second part is also have different part of training and events like today, webinars. They have annually, they have over 60 events all over Europe and in China. Most of the trainings, they'll provide focus on IPR issues, for example, like technology transfer or how to register a trademark, etc. The third main service is they provide guide and newsletters. Their IP guides covers all type of areas, and I was told actually so far they have 20 plus available for download from their website. So any information that you need, you want to read, and newsletters and updates, you can try to find under the IP guides and newsletter. The fourth type is the online services. They have the e-learning modules, and also they set up a new blog, which will give you update of China IP laws and cases, which should attract people who has interest in China and also Southeast Asia. They also have online videos of past events and also recordings of past webinars, and they also have a podcast as well. So this is all the major services that I introduced for you. And here is the website for the China IPR Help Desk and also the Southeast Asia IP Help Desk. And of course, you can also follow them on the social media, on Facebook, and Twitter, LinkedIn, etc. Here is actually listed a couple of countries in Southeast Asia, but they actually have over 10 countries across in Southeast Asia with all the focusing on IPR help desk for the European SMEs. So you can check the website here.
Wonderful.
Thank you. And here a little bit of advertisement for the upcoming events in China. Well, coming on this Thursday, we'll have a actual event for this online business for SMEs in China. And then upcoming in later April in Shanghai for another 2 events. And also there will be trainings in Europe starting from 16th of April and then 17th and also later in May. For the details, you can check on the website china-iprhelpdesk.eu. I hope you find them helpful. And okay. Finally, now it starts to my presentation. And actually, I skipped the introduction of myself. I'm Stacey Yuan. I'm from working with Jones Day, which is an American law firm. And I've stayed in Beijing practicing IP laws in China since early 2005. And you can find my email address later on. If you have any question, you can email the EU SME Help Desk. You can also email the IPR Help Desk, or if you want to, you can reach me as well. Okay, now I believe Chris has already introduced, you know, the major B2B and B2C websites in China. Here is, again, some of the logos. Okay, so I'll give a couple of examples about when, how about you see some infringing products on Taobao? What do you do? Sorry, next one. Okay. So on this, on here, I have a screenshot. Actually, this is the Taobao website. They set up an online IPR complaint system. And on your right, you see it's Alibaba online complaint system. The reason why they set up the online complaint is actually because with the business significantly increasing, a lot of people complain about counterfeits, about infringing lookalike products on those websites. So now they have set up a fairly sophisticated website that you can launch your online complaint. The online complaint will be more effective, and it's easier and it's quicker. And normally, they will respond to your request in about 7 days, fairly quick. So now we go into the next slide. Filing an IPR complaint. I'll just briefly introduce you to, you know, to get a sense that how does it look like. So first of all, you need to register an account for filing the IPR complaint, so opt as a rights owner. And then you can upload your IPR rights for verification, for example, a copy of your trademark registration certificate. And then if you see any infringing links, for example, a counterfeit ones or look-alike ones, or somebody's using a similar trademark to your registration, then you can file complaints through this online system. Once you're registered, actually each time you can complain about 100 to 200 links per complaint. So you have to copy and paste the infringing items, the link, into the complaint system. That's after you register your account. So this is actually fairly effective. You can complain about the same type of rights against about 100 to 200 links. So that makes it very effective time saving. And that means just save money.
How quickly do they respond?
Normally, they respond in 5 to 7 days.
Wow, that's very quick.
Yes, very quick. Yes. But you only get, you don't get to call them. You only get their online service provider to through online chatting, that you, if you have any follow-up questions. But normally, they will return the response to you so that you can receive. But if you have further questions, follow up, you can only find the online chatting service and to talk to them about your complaint.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sure. Okay. Do you have to be registered in China to access this?
You need to register an account with them.
Right.
But it doesn't have to be a Chinese company. It can be a foreign company. Oh, you can register an account with them. Yes.
So even if you're not based in China?
Yeah, even if you're not based in China. Yes.
Okay.
Okay, now how to do takedown of copycat websites? Actually here, what I've covered just now is about finding infringing items on offering to sell on Taobao. But now how about you find a copycat website, which a couple months ago, I just working for one of my clients in Taiwan, they're based in Taiwan. Their product actually is not officially sold in China.
Right.
They haven't launched any official sales channel in China yet. But what they find, actually where their customer finds, is a Chinese website copying the same layout, images, product information, and product descriptions of client's website. Mm-hmm. So they literally set up a whole copycat website in China, and it's targeting Chinese consumers.
Okay.
It's not necessarily they're selling counterfeit products, they may be, but they're selling products in an extremely low price. Mm-hmm. That is very suspicious that could be counterfeit. So what do you do in case you find these kind of copycats? Well, first of all, you have to identify the mastermind behind it. For example, if you see any contact information, if there's any delivery, and who registered the domain name.
Sure.
So who's the registrant, any information, any address, any telephone number to try to identify who are these guys. Are they a company or sometimes it's just individuals? Individuals and they're just thinking, oh, I can set up this website, try to sell, make some money, right? And secondly, you have to check about internet service provider, right, the ISP, which I'll go into the details one by one step in the next slide, so yeah. I can explain to you what are they and how you deal with them. Also including the ISP license and also check the IP address.
Sure.
There will be, once you find out there's a copycat website, there's a lot of investigations that you can do first online to try to find out who is your enemy,
yeah,
who we're dealing with.
Okay. How copied does the website have to be?
If you don't look at the domain name, you think this is absolutely the official website. And that's how close it is.
So they pass it off as you being your website?
Yes, it is. And they claim to be your official website.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now who will make a judgment of whether it is a copycat?
Well, I mean, for this one, the client told us it is a copycat because they definitely don't know these people. They haven't sell in China. They don't have a website under this domain name at all.
Yes.
So that, but from a consumer perspective, there's no way a consumer can tell.
Okay.
Absolutely no way, because they use the authentic pictures. They use all the pictures that clients' website have.
Okay.
They even have the same advertisement, the clips, the video clips, everything.
Okay.
So it's a totally identical copy of clients' official website. Okay. But only the difference is you can place an order and the address is different. Yeah, you're paying to a different company.
Right.
Okay, tailor a strategy. Now here I'm going to go through a little bit of details on whatever you find out this copycat, what can we do? The first step normally I would recommend to find out their IP address, which is fairly easy once you have their domain name, and then to see if this domain name is linked, provided by a ISP, which is a major, normally if it's a major internet content service provider, that means they provide the domain name, connect to the server, connect to the website. They provide the domain name resolution. So if you file a complaint with these major ISP, which normally will be China Telecom or China Unicom, which is fairly big national state-owned companies, these companies, they have fairly good procedure handling those type of IPR complaint. So you're just telling them this is a fake website, this is not our own official website. They can shut it down.
Okay.
What they do, actually, they can break the link through the domain name to the server. So
right.
Nobody else can access to this website anymore.
Okay.
But sometimes, you know, the copycats are can be very tricky. They're very smart, actually. They will have multiple IP addresses that lead you to have a difficulty to find out who is the real ISP provider. Well, sometimes they use a fairly small a subdivision or agent of a major ISP provider. So those small agents, they actually they're not very familiar to the IPR complaint system, and sometimes they're reluctant because you are telling them to cut off their own consumers, right? So so they're reluctant to do. So if you contact the ISP, they're not willing to cooperate. Sometimes you have to go to other solutions, which including you can file a complaint to the China Internet Information Reporting Center. This CIIRC mainly helps you to forward your complaint to the right local Ministry of Information and Technology, which we call it MIIT. Yeah, the MIIT, the reporting center will find the right local MIIT, which has the right jurisdiction over this matter. So they will do a preliminary review of your complaint. And then if they're convinced it's a legitimate complaint, they will forward to the local MIT, which the local MIT normally is very responsive, and they will help you within 5 working days. They can get it. They can cut a whole link.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yes, very effective. Or alternatively, sometimes if you find, it's too many fake IP addresses, they're bouncing between each other, with the resources you have, even the IIT, it concerns maybe 3 or 5 different cities across different province. So neither of them have the whole jurisdiction over this entire website. So they may have a little bit of conflict with jurisdiction issues. In this case, you may consider find one of the major city and to push the IIT to try to find more information about which is the major ISP or if they can help you at which jurisdiction.
Okay.
Sometimes filing complaint with the local administration for industry and commerce, which we call AIC, is very helpful too. But AIC mainly dealing with fair trade and trademark infringements. We have to make sure you have valid registered trademark in China covering your product. And you have to convince the AIC this is under their jurisdiction. Because normally they tend to leave the IMT to handle the online infringement matters. But sometimes AIC would help as well.
So, sorry, when you say the MIT, you're talking about the China Internet Information Reporting Center?
No.
Are you mentioning that again?
The reporting center is different than the Ministry of Industry and Information Technology.
But they report to the MIT anyway, right?
Yes. They will forward your complaint to the MIT.
Okay. Sure.
Yes. And also, there's another trick, which is sometimes if you find this copycat website does not have an ICP license, which is the Internet Content Provider license, which the China laws requires all the Internet Content Provider to have such. If they don't have a license, then the case become much easier because you can file a simple complaint to MIIT directly, just saying this website does not have ICP license. Just because of this license, they can close the website very quickly, sometime within 24 hours. But if they do have ICP license, then we'll have to see whether complain to the Information Reporting Center or whether to get some help from AIC or to find the local MIIT to complain. Okay. Yeah. Sometime you can complain to the MIIT directly.
You can close it in 24 hours, but how long does the decision-making process take?
Well, if the website does not have ICP license, it's 24 hours including from the time you file your complaint with MIIT until they close it.
Okay.
Very quickly.
Okay, that's good. Is there a special number for the MIIT for this?
No, I don't think so. There's an online system as well. Okay. There's an online complaint system as well.
Great.
Yeah. But mostly we'll send a formal letter to them and then follow up. Okay, now we get a more exciting part of this presentation, the online group purchase. I don't know how many of you are familiar with some website in the US called Groupon, where you can find some coupons as group purchase with a huge discount of maybe a set dinner, sometimes maybe a holiday package, sometimes it's maybe like a spa treatment package for a huge discount. Those group purchases actually has changed a little bit since they come into China. And now I'm going to show you how these group purchase websites look like. Okay. All right. I've listed five major group purchase websites here. So you can see some of them actually group purchase mobile phones. Some offers for dinner set. That's a Korean barbecue on the left. And then on the right, there's some other food, and on the bottom right with the 57 Tuan, that actually offers Echo branded shoes for a huge discount.
Yes.
Mainly it's like 80% off.
Yes.
I'm going to go into details about these major different type of group purchase website. But the reason why I bring this up is because these actually become very difficult to deal with if they sell counterfeits. Because if they sell counterfeits on Taobao, Taobao has already set up the online complaint system, and you can identify them, you can identify the shop. Mm-hmm. Whereas group purchase, the nature of the group purchase normally is only valid for 3 to 5 days mm-hmm. for each offer. Mm-hmm. And then once the offer is done, you can't find any other information. It's done, it's gone.
Yes.
You can't even find a sample to purchase. So you only have 3 to 5 days to react. So it brings more challenging to us. And also different type of group purchase website. Some, they're decent website. Some, we suspect they just set up only for the purpose of selling counterfeits for cheap price. And, you know, group purchase, that means there's a huge group of people who's buying from this website. So each offer, within 5 days, probably they can solicit over 10,000 of people who place orders on these. So the effects actually could be very severe. It's very serious, rather than individual links, counterfeits you find on Taobao. Okay, now we see this. There's an example of Christian Dior the perfume. The selling price here is only 198 RMB, which equals about 20 plus euros.
Yes,
and the discount rate it says here is 85% off.
Yes.
So you can see that this is a typical advertisement for from one of the group purchase websites.
Yep.
And now we can...
And 60 people already buying it.
Yes, 60 people already. Actually, this is actually means 60 people already paid for it.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, let's find another type. Here, this one. I have a little bit... This is a Nike Air Max. It's a running shoes.
Yes.
This one, it shows it's 89% off
yes.
the original price. And there's a time. It says only 8 hours and 26 minutes left. That's when we took the screenshots.
Okay.
So that's just give you a sense of how quick these things could be over. Sometimes valid for 24 hours. Right. Sometimes it's 3 days. The maximum I have seen before is about 5 to 7 days.
Yes.
I haven't seen any group purchase offer longer than 7 days.
Yes. This one actually says guaranteed real.
Oh, yeah. They all said the guaranteed real.
Okay.
Yeah. And you can see for this one, it's already 49,000 of orders made already. And that's, you know, another... yeah, exactly. This one is quite shocking. And then we'll see another couple of examples here. Just, you know, to give you a sense, all kind of products they're offering on these group purchase websites. Mainly the discount are all rather really, really low just to attract orders. And these sneakers, I mean, yeah, we calculated this price just can't be real.
Okay.
Yeah, but of course, you know, sometimes it could be real. But that's what we say, until we receive certain information, we probably couldn't tell if it's real or not. But sometimes if we work with our client, they'll tell us for this model, they definitely don't have.
Yes.
For example, here, there is actually some model that Echo never had, never launched.
Right.
And for this website is one of the serious one, because this website, we've done some search that they're mainly selling all different kind of shoes with a, you know, well-known brands of shoes. And they periodically come back with the same brand for a huge discount, but for different type of shoes.
Okay.
For those ones, actually we sense most of them are counterfeits. So they are some of the group purchase website. They're sourcing from different providers. They source from different restaurants. But for this type of website, we suspect they only source or they work with or the probably potential this website was set up by the counterfeit manufacturer, which they provided the wholesale through this way because they know it's difficult to catch them. I don't know if you can notice here, the only contact information is a QQ number,
yes.
QQ, which is the chatting tool. There's no telephone number, there's no email address, only this QQ number. If you have questions as a buyer, you can ask them through the chatting, which again, if we want to catch them, it creates a lot of difficulties in practice.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Now, difficulties. As I just mentioned, this time limit is very tight on these group purchase website, and it's very difficult to identify the supplier because the website only says there's a group purchase order, but they would never disclose if it's a distributor, if it's a supplier, or if it's the manufacturer. They won't say. They're just saying this is this product with a huge discount. Hard to trace any location. We've actually tried to order a couple of items from this website.
Right.
Normally, you know, on the courier bill, we'll see who's sending the parcel from which address.
Mm-hmm.
But for those ones, actually, there's only a surname, which normally is a fake one, and probably a mobile number or numbers after these 2 days is no longer valid.
Right.
There won't be any address information up here on the courier bill because these people, they know what they're doing.
Yes.
Yeah. And if you just say, oh, is the wrong size or is the wrong item, can I return them?
Yes.
Most of the time, you can't find them.
Okay.
Sometimes you can contact the website, they say, oh, they give you a random address, you can just return. To be honest, they don't really care one pair of shoes returned to them or not. So normally they give you a fake address.
Right.
You just send it.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Potential solutions now. Well, facing the difficulties doesn't mean we don't have solutions.
Yes.
But of course, you know, the solutions sometimes may be complicated because we are dealing with very complicated people. Infringing listings on group purchase website. Those ones are easier ones that we believe the website itself is a very decent one. Then they just occasionally solicited somebody actually offers counterfeits to this website. So we normally write a warning letter to them and demand them to disclose a lot of the information. Where did the source is from? Who's the supplier? Normally, sometimes they will give us some information. But these information, again, if you trace further, it could lead us to the real source. Sometimes it couldn't. It's really case by case. And second scenario, the group purchase website with massive counterfeits. That's the example we just saw with massive the shoes.
Yeah.
For these websites, we'll monitor them and notarize the sample purchase. For example, we'll make a couple of online orders each time they have this group purchase of the same brand. And then we notarize the online order, like when we place order, when we wire the money, online payments, and then to notarize the delivery, the sample. Sometimes we ask them to deliver to the notary's office, but on the ground floor, so they can call the notary and the notary will come down to pick up from the delivery. That way we can actually complete the whole evidence chain.
Yes.
An investigation. Once we order a couple of different samples from the same supplier, we will get a better sense of where does it from. And sometimes we communicate with them, can we return a couple of items, etc. So these are all the informations lead to further investigations. At least we know which province or which city we should go to. And sometimes the courier company, they do have tracking numbers. But if you log in the system, the tracking number sometimes shows which area or which employee of the courier company pick up this parcel. Sometimes the investigator can try to approach those people who work for the courier company to try to get a sense where they normally pick up these products.
Okay.
Yeah.
There will normally be a company which is behind these these schemes.
Yes, they will, normally. And there will be a warehouse that they use to send all the counterfeits.
Okay.
And so you see, if you order, for example, for each time, if you order three different designs or three pieces, we find probably on all of the three, the sender's name and mobile number is different.
Yes.
But they all picked up from the same area because the courier service now they have divided different streets or different community or neighborhood into different area. We can find which area it was sent from.
Okay.
So normally we can trace from there.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you've got there at the bottom, complaint with relevant authorities. Can you just tell us a bit more about that? Who are the relevant authorities?
Well, relevant authorities, including the AIC, which I just talked about.
Yes.
The AIC is mainly dealing with enforcement of trademark and unfair competition.
Okay.
So they are actually become more and more professional and sophisticated with IPR complaints.
Okay.
They do have a separate department called the trademark department, or sometimes the trademark trade department, which is mainly dealing with enforcement. Enforcement actually, when we file the complaint, we find who is the seller, where the products, etc. The AIC will take actions. They will go and seize all the counterfeit products, and later on. They will do some investigations, and later on they will order to destroy all the products, and normally they will order a penalty, a fine, against the infringer. But the fine goes to the National Treasury. It doesn't go to the rights owner.
Oh, right.
Okay.
It doesn't seem very fair.
Well, I mean, rights owner...
Yes.
And the rights owner, if you want to pursue further, based on these AIC penalty decisions, you can bring a civil litigation to a Chinese court.
Okay.
Now, domain name scams and disputes. We have a poll that you can read this through first before we launch the poll. Have you ever received an email from a so-called domain name registry that the email content is similar to below? Yesterday, one company named blah, blah, blah applied for the internet brand of your brand and some domain name with us. We need to confirm one thing with you before the registration. Did you consign the company to register these? Are they your sub-branch? Are they your licensee or authorized? Because they are conflict with your trademark, please contact us ASAP. So now let's launch the poll.
So we're now going to launch the poll, and if you'd like to just register your answer to Stacey's question, you can do so now. There's quite a few people saying yes, I think.
Wow.
Which is a bit scary. And so we're going to close the poll now. I think enough people have answered. And share with you the results. So in fact, 44% of the people said yes.
Wow, actually, I wanted to ask you what did you do about it after you received it?
Yes.
I mean, because the reason why I asked this question is actually because a lot of my clients, they receive the same email as well. And they will normally forward the email to me and ask, what is this about?
Yes.
What do we do about it?
Yes.
Okay, let me tell you what you do. This is a typical scam email. that normally you find it's a rather small company, which is not a approved registrar right. for domain name. And sometimes they call it the internet keyword, which is a pure Chinese thing, which is not as popular as domain name, but it runs and a whole different system that people can key in a key internet, a keyword, for example, IPR help desk, for example, and then that keyword without a domain name, it can link you to the website that has registered the internet keyword. But this is not as popular in China, but normally they'll bring it up because they're trying to sell you for a very high price for registering these internet keywords. The reason why you receive this email is mainly because these registrars, they want to solicit a business from you. Registering a domain name with them could be very, very expensive.
Right.
Normally, it's probably four times the normal price you can register with a large and decent registrar. The reason why they're sending this email is just trying to solicit you to respond to them. They want you to be nervous and concerned, and then they will say, oh, you can register all these domain names with us, so nobody else will register.
Right.
I mean, these emails typically will suggest client to ignore. But behind ignoring the email, we also at the same time, you raise the same question. Do you have enough registration for your domain name? Right. Do you have enough trademark registration? Because trademark registration is the key thing. Because if you don't have a trademark registration in China, if somebody else really registered your trademark as a domain name, it's very difficult to get it back because you don't have the trademark registration.
Yes.
Or sometimes somebody else already registered trademark and they use this trademark to register the domain name.
Yes.
So in that sense, once you start to launch your products or thinking of having a .com.cn domain name, for example, in China, you will find out that somebody already using it.
Yes.
Somebody already solicited sales and promotions of similar products to your products.
Right.
And that will put you in a very difficult situation.
Okay.
So first of all, you can ignore the emails. But the second, watch out what kind of IPR rights do you have in China?
Okay.
And ask yourself, do you want to register some different variations of domain name?
Okay.
For example, I just use my own name, Stacy. If your brand is Stacy, you consider you should register stacy.com.cn,
right.
of course. But how about stacychina.com.cn? Right. How about stacycn or cn stacy? How about stacy half in China?
Yes.
Or how about stacy in China?
But you have to own the domain name first, right?
Yes.
For these different variations.
Yes, but you can start thinking registering some of these variations.
Yes.
Right? And with .com.cn or with .net, .co, etc. But of course, you know, we as SMEs, we have limited budget. We have to utilize
yes.
our budget.
Yeah.
How do we prioritize? So for these things, I would recommend you to consider what are the most important variations and what are the most important domain names that you consider. Because registering domain names can be very cheap. And to maintain them actually just costs about 10 to 15 euros. Sometimes if you register more, you can get a pretty good discount with registrar. So maintaining them is not as expensive. But once it's been hijacked by cyber squatters, it will take a lot of money.
Right.
It will. It will take quite substantial, sometimes quite substantial to buy it back. Or you can file a dispute, which I'm going to cover in the next, with, which is the domain name recovery.
Domain name recovery.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay. So for global top level domain names, for example, .com or .net, you can file complaints with CTAC, is the China Economic Arbitration Center, and the Hong Kong International Arbitration Center, and the Asia Domain Name Dispute Resolution Center, which is actually operates through CTAC and HKIC, all file complaint to WIPO. You know, all of them actually have very standard arbitration rules and procedure for domain name recovery. Normally, it's relatively very fast.
Okay.
But for .cn domain names, because it is a country-level domain name for China, within the 2 years since your registration, you can file complaint with CTAC and HKIC.
Okay. What are the administration costs for this?
The cost is not substantial compared to the legal fees. Yeah, normally it's probably say including the legal fees, depends on the complexity of the case, but sure. a few thousand euros should be okay. Yes. But if when you identify this hijacked domain name, it has registered for over 2 years. If it's a dossier domain name, then you can only initiate a civil litigation in China okay. with the Chinese court. Because these dossier domain names, they are administered by the CINIC, by China Technology Information Center, which according to their rules, domain name registered after 2 years can only be resolved through a litigation in Chinese courts. Great. So that will bring up the cost. Okay, now it's coming to the last few pages. Takeaway message. Well, I've always emphasized probably in each of my presentation, to obtain a valid IPR in China is very, very important, critical. For example, registering a trademark probably take you about 2 to 3 years
yes.
before the trademark is approved and registered with the trademark office.
Wow. Okay.
So even before you're launching your products in China, I strongly recommend you consider registering your trademarks
okay.
and a domain name.
When you're going through the registration process, and you're in the process, you're saying it takes 2 to 3 years, are you protected during that period?
Not exactly.
Right.
What you protected is actually the priority date. When you file the application, you protect your application against all the later applications, which is similar to your application. But while you're using your trademark, when it's unregistered in China, it's very difficult to enforce that trademark against infringers because okay. it's unregistered.
Okay.
But you can still use it, but it's very difficult to enforce against infringers.
Okay.
Monitor the online market. As I just said, monitor some of these group purchase websites and also monitor Taobao and Alibaba and Tmall. Actually, because as Chris introduced earlier, on Tmall you have to be a registered business.
Yes.
So it's rarely we can see a large number of counterfeit on Tmall. But on Taobao it's different. It's mainly C2C or small business to consumers that we can find hundreds or thousands of counterfeit links. And of course we have to choose, we have to give priority of which type you wish to file complaint. Take quick actions. Whenever you find something, don't sit on it. You know, consult with lawyers or consult with at least to look through some guide to understand your situation and try to seek lawyers for professional advice. Come up with a strategy. Sometimes you have different options that you don't have to just go after one option. Of course, if budget allows, a strategy can be complicated.
Right.
We can do a lot of things in parallel to achieve the best outcome. But of course, again, if the budget doesn't allow, we can prioritize a couple of matters, you know, a couple of options. Sometimes some option that is not expensive but can be very effective.
Great.
Launch your own online stores. That, again, I think for Taobao and Tmall is definitely recommended for you to launch your online store.
Okay.
Once people search your products online, mainly, I guess, there's just share my own shopping habit as well. I search the price on Taobao first, probably.
Yes.
And if I see there's an official online store, even if it's a little bit expensive than other not official flagship store,
yes.
I'll choose the official one because it guarantees the authenticity. And normally, the service is better.
Yes.
Yep. And that's, again, a very effective tool. If you have your own online store, it's easier when you file complaint or you can do advertisement so people know where to get the genuine products.
Okay.
And register domain name for defensive purpose. That again is for some combinations, as I just said. You know, you can choose a few prioritized combinations of your brand and maybe China or CN or something else or with your products.
Sure.
So for that one, you have at least covered some of the domain name that you have most concerned you. So if somebody else even later on hijacked something, a different variation, probably you don't care that much. Because you already have a few that are the most confusing ones that you already have. So people wouldn't hopefully people wouldn't confuse by these other variations.
So you've selected the core domain names which you're to protect yourself against, I guess.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
And so I guess we have a question and answer session.
That's right. I mean, if if we don't get through all the questions in today's webinar, I think we've only got about 5 or 10 minutes, well, about 5 minutes left of today's webinar. So we can only answer a few questions. If we can't get through all the questions today, then please feel free to email Stacey, and you can see her email address here. Or you can ask a question to the experts at the ESME Center as well by accessing our website and then hitting the Ask the Expert button. Okay, so you can get that. Yeah. You can ask us a question that way as well. And then obviously if you want to ask a more general question or questions to the IPR SME Help Desk, then you can access them via these email addresses as well, which you can just see here. Okay. So just we've got a few questions now, which we're just going to handle. So maybe thank you very much, Stacey, for your very, very informative presentation. Let me just get back here. Yeah, this is just the overview slide. So as I was saying, we've got a few questions from some of the audience. Perhaps I can give you a bit of a rest. Actually, you've been talking for so long.
That's okay. Yep.
Well, you can help me. You can help me answer these, actually.
Definitely.
So the first question: do you think that someone should try to enter in Chinese market, online market, as an everything seller company, or is it better to enter in a specialized web page, such as Yihaodian or Jingdong or others? Well, I think I mentioned this to a certain extent before, that if you want to become a Taobao in China and you're a foreign company, it's actually very difficult. To become, to get the internet content provider license for a commercial internet content provider license is actually very, very difficult. And I think only Chinese companies are really receiving this license from the authorities at the moment. So what you can do is sell your own goods via your website, but becoming a Taobao in China as a foreign company can be is very, very difficult. Although I think there's the potential to do it via joint venture.
Or you can set up a joint venture, or you can enter into some distribution agreement with some Chinese companies who can do the online settings for you.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. The second question is about, do you think it's better to focus in the big cities because of their development, or in eastern coast cities that have bigger potential of development on a long-term period? Well, I think that very much depends on your product, who you consider your target market to be, the varying levels of the product. And also, as I mentioned before, you also have to do the checks on the service providers in terms of logistics.
Yep.
Because getting to some of these second and third tier cities for sensitive goods, temperature sensitive, fragile goods, can actually be very much of a challenge.
Yep.
And so some companies are factoring in developing their own logistics infrastructure in order to tackle this problem. So there's a few things to consider there: type of product, and then doing the background searches in terms of who will be able to get your product to the markets that you're going out to at the moment. Got a question for Stacey here about cyber squatting. What is cyber squatting? I suppose that's about the domain name, especially in China, and how do you combat it?
Well, I think I already covered some information about cyber squatting in the earlier presentation. Mainly is people who either they took your trademark to register a domain name, or sometimes they do a variations of your domain names, or the copycat website, that they set up a totally different domain names, and then to set up the website that look like your official website. How do you combat it? I think we have go through a few slides on the strategy. If you have more particular questions about your product or your the difficulties that you are facing, that you can send me an email, then I'm happy to give you some preliminary advice on that.
Okay. And then actually a bit of a tough question here is, you know, you mentioned a lot of products that are being counterfeited here. I mean, the question is, what is the volume of counterfeit products on the luxury market in China? That's a very difficult question to answer, but I guess from your presentation, it's a significant amount at the moment.
Yes, yes, it is. And actually, you know, let me remind you, I think in 2011, I've seen a report from the European Commission that 80 or 85% of counterfeit that has seized in Europe border is came from China.
Yes,
and that just show you how serious it is. Not only, you know, being manufactured in China and sell to Chinese consumers, but it's also export to the Europe, to the U.S., to Middle East, to Africa as well.
Okay.
Yeah. So the exportation of counterfeits is another issue. And that actually affects the overseas market, not only in China, the whole global market.
And how can you protect yourself against that?
Well, a quick and simple one of the option is actually if you have a registered rights for a patent or trademark, you should file a recordation with the China Customs. They have an online recordation system. So the Chinese customs is actually one of the customs in the world that they do exempt the products going out of the border.
Yes.
So they will exempt the products, although the rate is relatively not very high. They only have the capacity to intercept about 3% of the products going out.
Oh, wow.
But considering the quantity they're dealing with every day, the actual amount of products they actually exempt is still quite large. And we do see after some of our clients register, file the recordation with the customers of their rights, we do receive notices from the customer whenever they encounter some suspicious counterfeits.
Okay.
And also we can give them a blacklist.
Yes.
If we find certain manufacturers that definitely counterfeit, they are not authorized, we can give the customer a blacklist. If they find any information about this blacklisted company, it will ring a bell and they will ask us to verify the products.
Okay. So it is an effective mechanism for preventing
export. Yes, because the Chinese customer doesn't charge anything to do all the examination of the goods, I mean, to the rights owner. So this is actually, once you spend a little money to file the recordation, all the rest is the Chinese customer. They will examine all the goods going out of border every day.
Yes.
And then until they find some counterfeits, between this period it's all free.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's relatively very effective and a very cost-effective way.
Okay. Thank you very much for that answer. And then I think we will handle one more question on ICP licenses. We've mentioned it both in our presentations, especially for standalone websites in China. Is the ICP only requested for B2B platforms? Well, I think Stacey mentioned this before. It's for any website which is registered on a server in China.
Yes.
You need an ICP license. And really what it helps you with is if there is any infringing content on your website, then the authorities at least will give you a phone call before they take it down, before they take down the content. I think that's one of the advantages. So if you're on a website outside China, you don't need the ICP license. But actually, there is a risk that your website will be taken down because many times the authorities will not just block your website, they will block a server.
Yeah.
So say you're, for example, you're on a service provider who has many websites on their servers, as you can imagine, and your website is just one amongst the others, and one of those websites is infringing, and they decide to block the server, then unfortunately your website will be blocked as well. So there is a high risk if you're outside, and obviously you don't need the ICP license, that you will be blocked.
Yes.
Yes.
And actually, if you're targeting Chinese consumers, I mean, theoretically, if you have your server overseas, you don't need the ICP. But if you target the Chinese consumers, the Chinese consumer access to it, ultimately, actually, the government will identify that. They will find out. If they find out, they will probably require you to have an ICP license.
Okay.
Yes.
That's great. Okay. I think that's all we've got time for today in terms of the questions. As I said, if there's any other further questions that you would like to ask Stacey or myself, or any of the other experts at the USME Center or the IPR SME Help Desk, please feel free to contact us at the emails. This webinar will be posted online tomorrow morning on our website, and you can download it for free from our website once you register. And so it's all left to say thank you very much to Stacey for joining me today in today's webinar. And thank you to all the audience for helping us or joining us today. And thank you to Anita, our operator here, for helping us out with the webinar today. One last message is, before we close off, there'll be a survey, and if you could just give us your opinion on the webinar and what you thought of it, that would be very, very helpful for our future webinars as well. So we look forward to seeing you in the next webinar. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you.